Good evening. Welcome back to the house of God. Thanks be to God that we are back here to hear his word, to respond in prayer and praise and thanksgiving. Thank you all for heeding our warnings and spreading yourselves out in the church building. I know it's hard for those of you who are forced to sit in the front. Some of you do on a regular basis, so we're okay. You will notice there are a few minor changes to the way things are done here. I'm sure one of the first things you notice, there are no hymnals. Again, that has to do with a little bit of, you know, just trying to avoid contact and handling things. So everything you need today is printed out in the bulletin. We use a little bit extra paper and a little bit of extra time typing things out, but that's okay. It's our regular order of service. It's Divine Service 3, it's page 184. There really haven't been any changes made other than the fact that it's now all typed out in the bulletin for you. The other thing that you'll notice as a significant change is that there will be no offering collected during the service. The offering plates, there's one by the back door and there's one here by the side door to receive the offerings either when you come in or on your way out, but it won't be collected during the service itself. We are still recording for YouTube, so any of our shut-ins and anyone who is prefers to be remaining home even now, they're certainly welcome to do so, and we will still make the recorded services available to them, and so we welcome all those who are watching this service as well. We begin. Our first hymn is Praise to the Lord. And as always, we've missed this for a while too. We begin with the ringing of the bells. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me
my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
May God be gracious to us and bless us.
And may his face shine upon us.
That your way may be known on earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy.
For you judge the peoples with equity, and guide the nations upon the earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase.
God shall bless
us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, in the word of your apostles and prophets, you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for the second Sunday after Pentecost is written in the 19th chapter of the book of Exodus. The people of Israel set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel. So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. On your wondrous works I will meditate.
And I will declare your grace.
The epistle reading, the letter of St. Paul to the Romans, the 5th chapter. While we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given. But sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother; James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus; Simon, the Cananean; and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying. Give without pay." This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
In the name of Jesus, amen. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Indeed, this is the reason that our Lord Jesus Christ has come into the world, to be the good shepherd of the sheep. And so our Lord Jesus looks out on the crowd with compassion. And for some of the things that are mentioned here in this gospel lesson, it makes perfect sense. There were those who were sick, who had diseases, many of them incurable diseases. So, of course, our Lord has compassion and heals them. There were those who were possessed by demons, afflicted by evil spirits. So, of course, our Lord has compassion and drives out the evil spirits and frees them from such oppression. When it says that the people were harassed and helpless, we could perhaps think about the Romans, whom the Jews considered to be a foreign and invading power, certainly not welcome, an oppressive government to the people. And so indeed, the Lord would have compassion upon those who had been abused by the Romans, by tax collectors who had taken too much, by soldiers who dealt violently with the people. Perhaps Jesus also saw the religious leaders of his day, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, in their own way oppressing the people by imposing upon them so many rules and so many laws and so many things that were difficult to follow. If we think of the people as victims, it makes perfect sense that our Lord Jesus would have compassion upon all of them and seek to help them. But it's not that simple. It's not that simple because many of the people who were part of that crowd were not victims. They were sinners. Perhaps some of them even criminals. Those who had broken God's law, those who had broken man's law. Perhaps many of the things that afflicted them, many of the things that they considered to be pains and difficulties in life, were not things that were imposed by others on them, but were things they had brought upon themselves. What if they were sick because of their own conduct? What if they had harmed or injured themselves? What if they were punished rightfully as criminals? If they had been beaten because they were thieves or murderers or adulterers? And indeed, many people in those among that crowd would have been. They were not all what we would have called good people. But there would have been scoundrels among them as well. People who had broken the law and had brought upon themselves all manner of pain and suffering. Even things like demon possession can be invited. It's the reason why, especially when I teach about the second commandment, which warns us about witchcraft and satanic arts and things of that nature, fooling around with those things is dangerous. A lot of people think it's just harmless, but if you're dealing with evil spirits, if you're, you know, inviting them in, if you're messing around with things like that, it can really cause harm. So here's my question to you. Does it matter to us if we're looking at someone else, if we're thinking about someone else, be it our friends, families, neighbors, in society, whatever, does it make a difference to us whether or not we have compassion if someone is an innocent victim or if someone has brought whatever it is upon themselves? See, to us, it makes a huge difference. It's a massive difference. We, as human beings, as part of our sinful nature, we find excuses not to have compassion on people, and the most obvious way we do it is to say they don't deserve it. Look at how they've lived their lives. Look at the things they've done. Look at the things they've said. Of course their lives are messed up. They brought it on themselves. Why would we have compassion? They can fix their own lives. Jesus has compassion anyway on all of them, even on those who brought whatever affliction it is on themselves, even those who we would say they should know better. Our Lord Jesus has compassion on them all and preaches to all and heals all. The way St. Paul describes this in his letter to the Romans, while we were still weak, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The compassion of Jesus to that crowd on that day, and really to all people of all times and places, the compassion of Jesus is not dependent on whether it's earned or deserved. Because let's be honest, when we're talking about our relationship to God, our standing before God, none of us can really honestly say that we deserve or are owed anything from God. But while we were still weak, while we were still sinners, Jesus died for us. Jesus had compassion upon us. Jesus shows his love, his mercy to us, even if we are the ones who should have known better, even if we are the ones who have brought all manner of difficulties upon ourselves. It's a wonderful statement of the gospel, of the good news, because it eliminates, understanding this rightly, eliminates two problems. It eliminates two things. For one, it eliminates pride. There is no room for pride. There is no room for arrogance. There is no way, honestly, rightly, to stand up to God and say, okay, God, you owe me, or I deserve. The compassion of God, the love of God, the mercy of God that we have in Christ, it is undeserved. In the church, we use the word grace, and that's basically the definition of grace or the meaning of grace. It's undeserved. It's unearned. But the love of God for his creation, for his world, for his people is so great that he has compassion on us anyway. He goes to the cross to suffer and die for us anyway. His preaching, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It is a call to repentance because Christ has taken away the sins of the world. Our repentance, our confession of sins is answered by God's absolution, by his declaration of forgiveness. You are undeserving. But God in his mercy has given his son to die for you. And for his sake, in his name, by his suffering and death, your sins are forgiven. And so there is no room for pride. The second thing is that there is no room for despair. This is the kind of the opposite of pride. Despair, hopelessness, says that things are so bad. And again, if we're talking about our own sins or our own mistakes in life, the things that we have brought upon ourselves, that temptation is there also to say it's so bad that even God can't forgive me. It's so bad that even God can't fix this. There's no room for despair. There's no room for hopelessness because, again, Christ has compassion on all. The death and resurrection of Christ is for the whole world. It is for all people, even for those who don't deserve it, especially for those who don't deserve it. Christ offers forgiveness. He offers salvation. He offers resurrection. To sinners, to the worst of sinners, to the most awful of sinners. Thanks be to God, because that's me. That's us. It is so common to look at the world, to look at everyone around us, and to basically, in our own heads, we kind of calculate. What have we earned? What do we deserve? What does everybody else deserve? But in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, it's all grace. It's all love, it's all mercy, it's all compassion. No pride and boasting, no hopelessness, no despair. But everything focused on the death and the resurrection of Jesus, everything focused on repentance and forgiveness, everything about the love of God, that the God who created us loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Thanks be to God. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Let us pray.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your mercies are new unto us every morning. And though we have not deserved your goodness, you continue to abundantly provide for all our needs of body and soul. We pray, give us your Holy Spirit, that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness toward us, give thanks to you for all your blessings, and serve you in willing obedience. Lord, in your mercy, save and defend your whole church, purchased with the precious blood of Christ. Strengthen your faithful people through the word and the holy sacraments. Make them perfect in love for you, in love for one another, and in all good works. Grant your wisdom and grace to pastors, to those who hold office in your church. Send the light of your truth into all the world. Raise up faithful servants of Christ to advance the gospel here and throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, preserve our nation in justice and honor. May we lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in our land, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of this state, and to all those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Send your blessing upon our armed forces, law enforcement. Help them to serve your people according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy, take away from us hatred, division, strife. Give us the spirit of love. Order our days in your peace. Prosper the work of those who work to bring peace and justice to the nations of the world. That compassion, justice, peace may increase among all peoples. Lord, in your mercy, sanctify our homes with your presence. Bless them with joy. Keep children in their baptismal faith. Enable parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Bless husbands and wives. Help them to fulfill the vows of love and faithfulness that they have made to each other. Unite the members of all families in love and service, that they may show forth your praise into the world. Lord, in your mercy, let your blessing remain upon seed time and harvest, commerce and industry, arts and culture. Take under your special protection those whose work is difficult or dangerous. Send your blessing upon all those who put their hands to any beneficial task. Give them the just rewards for their labor and the knowledge that their work is truly good service to the neighbor in your sight. Lord, in your mercy, by your word and spirit, comfort all those who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Be with those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow. Grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Bless the work of doctors, nurses, all health professionals who work to preserve and maintain health among your people. Lord, in your mercy, we remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you in your church on earth, who now rest from their labors, especially Don Roth, who has been called to rest. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints. Bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you know that we need, Grant unto us, O Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord Jesus Christ, creator and preserver of our faith, we thank and praise you for continuing to preach your gospel among us, for our instruction and spiritual growth. Send your blessing upon the word that we have heard this day. By your Holy Spirit, grant that we may know you better, be strengthened in divine truth, and remain steadfast in your grace. Give us strength to fight the good fight, to overcome all the temptations of the devil, the world, and our own sinful flesh, that we may finally receive the salvation of our souls. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Good evening once again, and welcome to all of you. Thank you for joining us again. It is certainly good to be back in the house of the Lord. The announcements have returned to our bulletins, so be sure to check those out as well. I just want to say a few words about our schedule, revised schedule as we are returning. The Saturday evening services will remain on the old schedule. So second and fourth Saturdays at 5 o'clock in the evening, obviously starting today. So the next Saturday evening service will be 2 weeks from today on the 27th. On Sunday mornings, for the indefinite future, we now have two services, one at 8 o'clock and one at 10 o'clock. Again, the idea there is hoping to spread out the crowd a little bit and prevent the church from having too many people in it, just in case there is still a danger from the COVID virus. So again, on Sundays for the indefinite future, 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. You may have noticed there was no communion this evening. We're holding off on that for just a little bit longer. We want to work out a few more details as to how communion distribution is going to be done. I can tell you that when we get into July, we will be back to our regular communion schedule, communion on the first and second weekends of every month, including whatever the first Saturday in July is going to be, I think the 11th. So when we get to July, we'll be back to communion services also. One note for those who are watching exclusively on YouTube, because of the change in the service schedule, it also means the services might get loaded onto the internet a little bit later than they have been. So if you don't see the services right away on Sunday morning, please be patient. Some of them might not get loaded until Sunday afternoons. I don't have complete control over that, but just be aware of it. If you're looking for our services every Sunday morning, it might be Sunday afternoons for the foreseeable future. So my apologies if you're looking for it and don't see it, but please be patient. Those services will be loaded to the internet. All right. As we're leaving this evening, please do be a little bit patient, take a little bit of extra time. We don't want a huge crowd, you know, gathering at the back. I will be greeting people in the back of church, but please do observe no handshakes, no hugs, as much as we'd like to. We're just kind of avoiding those things. So thank you. Have a good week.